What's up, y'all? I'm your host, Stan Becton, and you're listening to The NightStand, where we provide you with an intriguing social commentary on sports, entertainment, and more. We got an amazing show for you today, so stay tuned and listen up. What's good, y'all? Welcome back to The NightStand with Stan Becton. That's me, yours truly. If you haven't heard of me, you'll be hearing of me soon. Be sure to follow the show on Instagram at The NightStand Show and to subscribe however you're listening today. Go do that. Today, we have another exciting episode for you. The college football playoff is coming up this weekend, and we're going to get right into that.
That's football, guys. That's all it is.
This weekend, we finally have the college football playoff taking place. We have a matchup with two exciting games, four exciting teams, all happening Saturday, January 2nd. We're going to start off in Dallas, Texas with the Rose Bowl. Yes, the Rose Bowl got moved to Dallas, Texas because of COVID restrictions and there were no fans allowed in Los Angeles at the Rose Bowl. So they moved it to Jerry World. Dallas, Texas is home of the Rose Bowl. This year's Rose Bowl, you have number one Alabama versus number four Notre Dame. Alabama is coming off an undefeated regular season and SEC championship, and Notre Dame is coming off an undefeated regular season and a loss in the ACC championship. Alabama is a big favorite over Notre Dame entering this game, and a lot of the concerns are about can Notre Dame perform in a big matchup, because we know that time after time again, Notre Dame has come out flat in these primetime bowl games. Some matchups to watch for in this game include Jeremiah Owusu-Koramoah versus Najee Harris. This is my favorite matchup of the Rose Bowl because you have a supreme athlete at linebacker versus a supreme athlete at running back. Owusu at linebacker might be the first linebacker taken in the 2021 draft, and Harris might be the first running back taken in this draft. Look for Owusu to match up wherever Harris goes on the field and try to neutralize him in a lethal Alabama offense. When it comes time for the prediction, though, I think that the other weapons Alabama has will be the reason that Alabama ends up winning the Rose Bowl. I think that Alabama is too deep at receiver. Devontae Smith, player of the year. They have John Mechie. They have a lot of other weapons. And Mac Jones is also a Heisman finalist. I think the struggles you saw Notre Dame have against Trevor Lawrence in the ACC championship will once again reappear, only this time with Mac Jones and that Alabama offense, and Alabama will win this game. Up next in the college football playoff, we go to New Orleans, Louisiana for the Sugar Bowl. You have a matchup for number two Clemson versus number three Ohio State in this game. Some matchups to watch for in this game. Well, there are a lot because this team is star-studded on both sides. Well, number one matchup to watch for, Travis Etienne versus Baron Browning. Now, Travis Etienne might be the most dynamic athlete in college football. He has become an All-American once again as an all-purpose player. They flex him out of receiver sometimes, but he plays running back traditionally. The matchup I want you to watch for Ohio State is Baron Browning. Baron Browning, I think, can follow Etienne across the field. He's an athlete himself. I think that's a good matchup because it will allow Ohio State to focus on the other areas because you know Ohio State does like to play a lot of man coverage, and I think Browning is that athlete at the linebacker position that allows them to do that this game. The next matchup I have to acknowledge in this Clemson-Ohio State college football playoff semifinal is Clemson cornerback Darion Kendrick, a possible first-round pick, versus either Chris Olave or Garrett Wilson. Now, I don't know which wide receiver Kendrick will be following, if he's going to follow at all, but I think Kendrick versus either one of these can be a great matchup. And it's going to test Kendrick to see how good of a cornerback he is heading into the NFL draft. Olave might be a first-round pick this year. Wilson might be a first-round pick next year. I think Kendrick will be able to put himself up to the test and match up with these two receivers for that Clemson secondary. How well Kendrick performs will play a key role into how well Clemson performs in this game. Elsewhere, we got to go into the big boys. We got to go into the interior of the line of scrimmage. Let's go to All-American, unanimous All-American last year, Wyatt Davis at guard versus a stud freshman for Clemson on the D-line at D-tackle, Brian Breesy. Wyatt Davis might be the best guard prospect in the last few years in the NCAA. But Breesy, the consensus number one overall recruit last year coming in, has only performed well for Clemson this year. Wyatt Davis versus Brian Breesy will be a matchup to watch for because it will show how good Brian Breesy is against someone who has proven time and time again for that Ohio State offensive line that he can anchor the middle and prevent any interior pressure. Next up, you have Sean Wade versus Amari Rodgers. Amari Rodgers was hurt a lot of last year. He didn't play that much in that game against Clemson, if he played at all. I don't recall off the top of my head last year. But Sean Wade did play, and he got ejected. And that's part of the big reason he came back this year, when he could have been a first-round pick. Sean Wade, Amari Rodgers. Amari Rodgers does a lot of his damage in the slot. Sean Wade is best playing in the slot. He could have been a first-round pick last year off of playing in the slot alone. So look for Sean Wade to match up with Amari Rodgers a lot throughout the day, because Clemson's other wide receivers just aren't as big a name. So look for Sean Wade to want that matchup this game. Last but not least, I think we have to acknowledge the play calling matchup. Ryan Day on offense for Ohio State versus Brett Venables for Clemson on defense. Brett Venables is one of the best defensive minds in college football. His blitzes, his ability to quickly identify signs that other offenses are calling in. Venables is going to have a lot of plays dialed up for this Ohio State offensive attack. But Ryan Day, on the other hand, is going to come in motivated for a team that struggled in the red zone last year and looking to rebound. Yes, Ryan Day is the head coach, but he's an offensive background coach, and look for him to play a key role in the plays that are being called this Saturday. So who wins this game? You know, the last one was pretty short and brief, but this game, I think I have to get into my three-point stance.
1, 2, 3, let's go.
This week's three-point stance is that Ohio State will defeat Clemson in an upset in the college football playoff. Here's why Ohio State has what it takes to win this college football playoff semifinal. 1, Justin Fields. Justin Fields is a mobile quarterback. He can run with the ball. He can throw the ball at an elite level. And I think we saw some things last year in that Clemson game that showed that Justin Fields will be able to make plays off schedule against a Brett Venables-led defense. He blitzes a lot. He blitzes a lot. And I think Fields has just enough mobility to be able to avoid those blitzes and be able to create big plays down the field when they are needed. Next up, balance on offense for Ohio State. We saw in the Big Ten Championship, Trey Sermon, transfer from Oklahoma, was able to run for 331 yards. And this was when Justin Fields was struggling. I think this addition of the running game will prove to help Ohio State win this game. Because if we noticed last year, before J.K. Dobbins got hurt with his ankle injury, Ohio State was dominating that game. And look for the running backs, Trey Sermon and Master Teague. Don't forget about Master Teague. The two of them to have a good rushing attack on Saturday to allow Ohio State to defeat Clemson. Because look, when they open the offense up by running the ball, those two big play receivers I mentioned earlier, Olave and Wilson, will pose a threat down the field. So look for that running attack to be a key factor this Saturday. Lastly, in my three-point stance, point number three, I think familiarity would be the reason that Ohio State wins. Now, Dabo Swinney has said that, oh, it's easy to scout Ohio State. They have 6 games of film. But I think it's going to make it harder because you have less of their tendencies. When you only play 6 games, you don't have as big a field as tendencies. For Clemson, they played a full schedule. Ohio State knows what they're going to do. You have the film. You can know their tendencies. In this situation, they mostly run this. Yes, you can practice, but the bowl game break between the conference championship and the college football playoff bowls is shorter this year, so it's not that much time to prepare. So I think that that familiarity will come in handy, as well as I think that the familiarity will help Ohio State, because last year was more about what went wrong than what Clemson did right, because there were red zone struggles, there were bad calls. I think that with this familiarity, Ohio State will be able to attack Clemson in the red zone better, and that will play a key role, because if Ohio State attacks Clemson in the red zone, then look for this game to possibly get out of hand, as it should have last year. That's my prediction for the college football playoff. And I'm excited for this weekend's games. I'm excited for this weekend's games. You have big programs, story programs across the board. I'm excited. But let's get into another thing I'm excited for in college football, the Heisman Trophy. On Tuesday, January 5th, the Heisman Trophy will be announced. Yes, it'll be a virtual ceremony, but it's still a big deal. It's still a big deal. So voting concluded after conference championship Saturday, and here were the finalists. You had Kyle Trask, you had Mac Jones, Devontae Smith, and Trevor Lawrence. To give you a little bit of info about these finalists, Kyle Trask is on a historic pace right now. He has thrown for 4,125 yards, 43 touchdowns, and he probably would have surpassed Joe Burrow this season if they played the same number of games, who won the Heisman last year. Mac Jones, he picked up the pace where Tua left off. He's second in the nation in yards with 3,739 yards and 32 touchdowns. Devontae Smith, well, he's been the best receiver in the country by far. Picked up the slack when his running mate Jalen Waddle got hurt. Devontae Smith has 98 catches, 1,511 yards, and 19 total touchdowns. Last but not least, we have the glory boy, Trevor Lawrence. Trevor Lawrence is Trevor Lawrence at this point. The difference showed in the second Notre Dame game. But the question with him is, how many missed games can he miss and win the Heisman? So who should win the Heisman Trophy? Who should win the Heisman Trophy? Well, key word here is should. Should is Devontae Smith. He will be the first receiver since Desmond Howard in 1991. He is 300 receiving yards over the next closest wide receiver. He leads the country in catches. And the Heisman Trophy is called the most outstanding player in college football. With the Heisman Trophy being called the most outstanding player in college football, the person that should, keyword, should win the Heisman is Devontae Smith. He has been simply outstanding. He leads all other receivers in the country. And no matter what defenses try to do, he's been unstoppable this year. He's been the most outstanding player in the country. So Devontae Smith should win the Heisman. But who will win the Heisman is not Devontae Smith, in my opinion. Who will win the Heisman? I got to go with Trevor Lawrence. I think that Trevor Lawrence will win the Heisman because he's Trevor Lawrence. I think what Dabo Swinney said is kind of true. The Heisman should want to associate their name with a Trevor Lawrence. And I think Trevor Lawrence, it'll be more of a career achievement than anything this year. Yes, he's played spectacular. This is not to take away from how he's played this season. However, I don't think he's deserved it because he's missed so many games. If he played all the games, he would win by far. But he hasn't, so I don't think he deserves it. But I think he will win. Another key reason why I think he will win is because the split votes from Alabama. Najee Harris finished fifth, after all, in the Heisman Trophy voting. I think Devontae Smith, Mac Jones, and Najee Harris will all split votes from that southern region, and it'll hurt Alabama in the long run from getting another Heisman Trophy winner. You can look to Ohio State. You can look to Penn State for an example of this. In 1973, John Cappelletti won the Heisman Trophy from Penn State, and Ohio State, like Alabama this year, had three top five finishers. I think this will hurt Devontae Smith. It will hurt Mac Jones from winning the Heisman because they both were finalists, and I think that Trevor Lawrence will sneak in and win. I think he will win. Now, just look back in time. Let's go on a reminisce here. Imagine if Ohio State didn't split the vote. Archie Griffin would have three Heismans. He might have three Heismans if they didn't split the vote. That would be crazy. Or we might have had an offensive lineman. But that would have been crazy nonetheless. But I believe Trevor Lawrence will win the Heisman by default. Basically by default. That's all the football news I have for you today. And now it's time to get into another great sport. This weekend, we have a great matchup on par for us in the sport of boxing. We have Luke Campbell versus Ryan Garcia in that lightweight division on Saturday, January 2nd. It's going to happen in Dallas at American Airlines Arena. And let's give you a tale of the tape before we get into the analysis of this fight. Ryan Garcia, he's 22 years old, 20-0, 17 knockouts, 17 million IG followers. I had to throw that in there. And he's a rising star in boxing. His opponent, Luke Campbell, is 33 years old, a southpaw, 20-3, 16 knockouts, a 2012 Olympic gold medalist. You can see the big age difference. That's 11 years. Some storylines for this fight are as follows. The fight was originally scheduled for December 5th, but it's been postponed to Saturday because on November 10th, Luke Campbell tested positive for the coronavirus. Another storyline is this is Ryan Garcia's first fight with the big boys in his first 4 years professionally. It's going to be a measuring stick for if he can compete in a loaded, once again, a loaded lightweight division. Got Lopez, Lomachenko, Campbell himself, Davis, Haney, loaded. The question surrounding Garcia in this fight is he ready for this step up in competition? Next storyline for this fight is this is Luke Campbell's third title fight. In his previous two, he lost both times by decision to Jorge Linares and Vasily Lomachenko. So those are the storylines for this fight. So let's get into another storyline that could develop for the winner of this fight. Well, this fight is between the two mandatory challengers for a WBC belt holder in Devin Haney. The winner becomes the mandatory challenger, the sole mandatory challenger for Devin Haney. Now, Garcia has already said if he wins, he wants to fight Gervonta Davis. Of course, that's the money fight, the two biggest names in that division. And if Garcia wins, everyone knows boxing will officially have its next rising star, its next big star in the sport. If Luke Campbell wins, he's definitely going to fight Haney because he's going to want that belt that he has not been able to get in so long. So, who wins on Saturday night between this matchup of star lightweight division fighters? Well, to give you a little analysis of how these fighters fight before I give you my prediction, we got to look at Ryan Garcia first, the headliner. Ryan Garcia, in a lot of his fights I've watched, he likes to fight with distance and then catch him with that left hook if they're the same foot as him. Now, I haven't seen too many southpaw fights, so I don't know how that's going to work necessarily against a Campbell, but that's kind of like what Garcia likes to do. Garcia also has speedy hands, so when he's inside, he has speedy hands as well, and he likes to use them speedy hands with a combination of knockout power. He landed two first-round knockouts in his last two fights, so he has the power to knock people out. On the other side of the card, Luke Campbell, he is a very smart fighter, as Lomachenko. He gave Lomachenko some fits in their fight, and it was a split decision. It was a split decision, after all, when they fought. Campbell was also very hard to knock out. He's been knocked down, but I don't recall him being knocked out. You can go check. If you've seen him being knocked out, let me know, but Campbell has not been knocked out, to my knowledge, and to a lot of the boxing world knowledge. So, now it's time for my prediction for this fight. Saturday night, Luke Campbell, Ryan Garcia. My winner is going to be Ryan Garcia. I think Ryan Garcia will knock out Luke Campbell in round 11. I think Ryan Garcia will knock out Luke Campbell in round 11. Now, here's why. I think that COVID and that long layoff will hurt Luke Campbell. You've seen it slow up a Myles Garrett. You've seen it slow up a Cam Newton. You've seen it slow up a Lamar Jackson and other sports. Contact sport of football, by the way. And I think it's going to slow up a Luke Campbell. And it's going to have him fatigued in those later rounds of the fight. Because if anybody can tell you, I can tell you. Football shape and boxing shape is two different shapes. So if you see how it fatigues those football players, imagine how it's going to fatigue this boxer coming off that COVID-19. I also think that a Ryan Garcia will win the battles that they have inside due to his quickness, his remarkable quickness, I might add. Ryan Garcia might have the fastest hands in the sport, and I think that that's going to help him inside win a lot of those inside battles and land some key damage on a Luke Campbell. My third point for why I think Ryan Garcia will knock out Luke Campbell in 11 this week is because I think Garcia has that sneaky power. He's more powerful than Lomachenko, for sure. We know that for a fact now. We know that Garcia is more powerful than Lomachenko. And I think that when he catches Campbell, it's going to be a knockout, not a knockdown like Lomachenko had. So I have Garcia winning in 11 by knockout against Luke Campbell this weekend, and boxing will gain a new star. There will be a new star in boxing, and you might have a future face of boxing down the road as well. Ryan Garcia, knockout this weekend. Now, I just want to thank you for listening to another episode of The Nightstand with Stan Becton. That's me, yours truly. Be sure to follow the show on Instagram and to subscribe however you're listening today. Be sure to tune in next week as we give you more great content, and we should have a surprise for you next week as well. Stay tuned and just know that The Nightstand is your favorite show.